Hello and welcome to week four of the University of Pennsylvania's virtual football season presented by Independence Blue Cross and Steamfitters Local Union 420. My name is Matt Leon. Tonight we go back to November 13th, 1982, when the Quakers beat Harvard 23-21.
Hello and welcome to week four
of the Ivy League
University of Pennsylvania's virtual football season presented by Independence Blue Cross and Steamfitters Local Union 420. My name is Matt Leon. Tonight we go back to November 13th, 1982, when the Quakers beat Harvard 23-21.
Hello and welcome to the Franklin Field. Both teams are 6-2 overall. Both are 4-1 in the Ivy League. Penn losses to Lafayette and Princeton. Harvard lost to Army and Dartmouth. 22 years have passed since the University of Pennsylvania won an Ivy League football title. Today, on a blustery afternoon at Franklin Field, Penn can clinch a tie for that title. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Merrill Reese, all set to send you the action as Penn and Harvard, the two first-place teams, collide. Penn co-captain Mike Christiani summed up the team's feeling when he said, won the toss, so the Quakers will be kicking off as Harvard has elected to receive. Perhaps on this day, that is an advantage for Penn. Here is the kickoff, and Harvard will hold it and throw it to them. As he's bowled over in, out of the end zone, no run back. They will bring it out to the 20-yard line. So Penn in his first quarter will have the wind in their backs, and Harvard will be throwing into the wind. Harvard uses a multiplex offense, which means they do so many things. Here is the first offensive play of the day. They line up in a double wing. Motion to the near side. The handoff goes to Steve Ernest. Good running room as he comes across the 25, up to the 26 or 27. Kevin Bradley makes the tackle for Penn. Bradley, the leading tackler of the Quakers. A pickup on that play of 7 yards. So for the Crimson, a second down and 3. The football in the 20. Double wing. The pitch goes to Granger, the fullback, coming off tackle across the 30, across the 35, and up to the 37-yard line, where Ross Armstrong makes the tackle to the Quakers' secondary. But a first down for Harvard, and they will spot the football at about the 37-yard line. First and 10 on a pitch again to Granger off right tackle across the 40, and he is stacked up at the 42-yard line. Jim Cook makes the stop. Now, very often, the Harvard running plays will go to the right side, and there's a big reason for that. Senior by the name of Greg Brown. Second down and 5 for Harvard at the 42. The handoff to Ernst off the wing across the 45. Fumbles the football. Picked up by Cam Ross Armstrong, who runs it out of bounds at the 40-yard line.
I mean, that first fumble that we, you know, that started the momentum, and then we kind of built on that a little bit. And, you know, it's something when you get, you know, up on somebody, you start feeling like you're, you know, going downhill a little bit. And then we recognized, you know, we weren't getting pushed around by anybody.
Tim Chambers made the hit on Steve Ernst. The ball flew into the air, and it was fielded by Ross Armstrong in the air, and he took it out of the 40-yard line. To the first turnover of the game goes to Penn, and the Quakers offense on the field. The tailback, Steve Blacko. The give is to Reuben, who fumbles the football. There is a fight for the ball. We will see. Penn thinks they were on it. Penn thinks they were on it, and it might have been Mark Humbro who dove on top of the football. He did, and recovered the football. Penn lost a couple of yards on the play, but that is minimal compared to the damage that might have been done if the ball had been turned back to Harvard. So a loss of 2 on the play if Steve Reuben fumbled the football. Now Chuck Nolan comes in, and Steve Reuben goes out. Slot to the far side, second down and 12 for the Quakers, who still have the ball. Second down and 12, Gary Bura on a keeper. Comes across the 40, back across the 37, down close to the 36-yard line. Gary Bura on the quarterback keep. Joe Azzleby makes the stop for Harvard, but for Penn it will be third down at about 8.
As you mentioned at the beginning of the show, Steve Reuben got a start today at the fullback position, which is a new situation for him. They gave him the ball on first down. Maybe he was a little tentative, and fortunately, Penn got the ball back.
Third and 8 at the Harvard 37-yard line. Tight end goes to the far side of the field. Schulte, Bureau on play action, being chased, close to pass, completes to Schulte for a first down at the 25. Jeff Schulte, big blocks brought on the offensive line by Max and Ernie Glanz in the area, giving Gary Buehr time to find his favorite target, Jeff Schulte, who took it deeper in the harbor territory at the 25-yard line. Schulte has 22 receptions on the year. That ties him with Carl Hall. And, of course, he is the leading receiver in terms of touchdowns. First and 10 for the Quakers, driving at the harbor 25. The give to the tailback Flacco, across the 25, across the 22, and Steve Flacco down at the 20-yard line. Andy Nolan makes the stop for Harbor.
Nice balance so far in the Penn offense. That was a very important completion for Gary Buehr. It was a little simple pattern where they had twins to the right side, and Jeff Schulte dragged underneath the coverage. He had to leap very high in the air, make a tremendous catch. It's got to build confidence for both players.
A pickup of 5 yards on the carry, a second down and 5 for the Quakers. Chuck Nolan remains in as the upback. A wing to the near side, Jeff Schulte, the tight end. Now he goes in motion to the far side. The handoff goes to Flacco, who leaps over a man at the 20 and is still on his feet as he is finally dragged out at the 15, where he will be very, very close to another first down. We will see where they spot the football. From here, it appears that he is about a half yard away. Randy Scott made the tackle for Harvard, and he is less than a yard away from the first down marker. So third down, and make it about a half yard. No score in the game. 10:46 remaining in the first quarter. 10 on the move. It is a full house tee for the Quakers. Full house tee as Buehr turns, gives off to Nolan, who sends down to the 10 and has a first down. Chuck Nolan on the carry, following a block by Mark Hembro, and a first and 10 for the Quakers. They spot the ball right on the 10-yard line. Mike Dixon makes the stop for Harvard. Make it a first and goal from the 10. And do not believe he can get a first down. Has to score a touchdown. The backs in the eye. First and 10 for the Quakers at the Harbor 10. Backs in the eye. The wide receivers are split. Buehr into a long count. He pitches out to Flacco, who will not get far. He is hit at the 9. Maybe he gets as far as the 8, but not much more as Andy Nolan makes the stop. That is the third carry for Steve Flacco. He has picked up 10 yards. Randy Scott and Joe Margolis also in on the tackle. So second down and goal from the Harbor 8.
Harvard's creating a couple of different looks up front for the Penn offensive line to recognize.
The backs are in the eye. Again, a long count by Gary Buehr. He is rolling, still rolling, carrying himself, and he doesn't get more than maybe 2 yards as he is tackled close to the 5-yard line. Pat Fleming on the stop, and I think Gary Buehr had the option as he was looking for a receiver to clear. Nobody did, and he carried it down to the 5-yard line, where it'll be third down and goal from the 5. Third and goal as Buehr retreats. He's looking. He fires. The pass is juggled and dropped. The pass is juggled and dropped by Jeff Schulte. He would not have been in the end zone. He was at about the 2-yard line as he dove for the ball, had it momentarily. There is a penalty flag and a holding called against Penn. So even if he had caught it, it wouldn't have mattered because Penn is going to be called for holding right here. Harvard is going to decline. Steve Schulman is on, and Gary Buehr will be the holder. So it'll be a 27-yard attempt with the wind at his back. The ball is spotted. The kick is away. It's long enough. It's good. Penn's on the board. There's a timeout on the field with the score. Pennsylvania 3, Harvard nothing.
I don't remember it specifically, but I remember it was at the close end side of the field, and it was, I think it was a 23-yarder. Pretty routine and you know, glad it went through and certainly provided some stimulus to get the guys, excited about the momentum.
That Penn drive was 10 plays for 28 yards, culminated by the 27-yard field goal by Dave Schulman. Penn capitalizing on a recovery of a Harvard fumble. Penn is plus 11 in the turnover department this year, and that is one of the very biggest reasons for their success. It's 3-0 Penn. That was not a timeout charged to Penn. It was a delay of game, which we understand they took purposely to give Schulman a better angle. Here is his kickoff. It is high, end over end, bouncing in and then through the end zone, and Harvard will not run it back again as they will spot it out at the 20-yard line. 8 minutes and 40 seconds remaining here in quarter number 1.
Donnie Allard sets his offense. He goes again to a double wing, sends his wide receiver to the far side of the field. George comes in motion to the near side, and the handoff goes inside. It goes to Jim Garvey on a wing back around. Kevin Bradley makes the stop for Penn.
One of the things that the Penn defense is trying to do today is just stay very basic. They know that they're going to get blocked from all different angles, from all different looks, but it's still a very basic, simple approach that Harvard's using, and Penn's trying to avoid that confusion.
Second down and five. Again, it is a double wing formation. Play action by the quarterback, Allard, who is rolling to the near side, and he goes belted out of bounds at the 22-yard line, and he will lose on that play as Matt Finn had excellent pursuit on Donnie Allard and ran him out of bounds. Ran him out of bounds. David Smith also putting an awful lot of pressure on the passer. So it'll be a third down and seven for Harvard as Donnie Allard loses 2 yards on that play. Again, a double wing. Allard on a straight drop back, looking close, the pass incomplete. He wanted to go to his fullback, Mike Granger. The ball was incomplete, and some very intense pressure applied by Penn's left tackle, Jim Miller, and Harvard will have to punt. Have to punt against the wind. Here is Jim Villanueva's punt. It is a high floater, and Tim Chambers will call for air and take a fair catch at his own 45-yard line. First and 10 for Penn. They're at their own 45-yard line. 7:48 remaining to be played here in the first quarter. Steve Rubin back in as the upback. In motion to the far side goes the tailback, Flacco. The handoff goes to Rubin, who bounces off people, but the most he can get is a yard and a half, maybe 2 yards. And I'm sure the one thing Gary Buro wanted there was to go to Steve Rubin, give him the opportunity to handle the football. On his first carry today, he coughed the ball off your side. The backs are in the eye. Gary Buro faking. He sets up, looking, bombing deep downfield, incomplete. The intended receiver was sprawled at the 30-yard line, and the crowd is booing. They are screaming and yelling that Rich Sirik was interfered with. He was down at the 30-yard line.
There was definitely a collision out there. John Daly for Harvard knocked Sirik down while the ball was in the air. He didn't intend to do it, but I believe that's got to be interference.
So for Penn, it is a third down and nine. Gary Buro retreats again. He looks. He swings it out to Flacco at the 45. Flacco running to the near side, across midfield, and into Harvard territory at the 49-yard line. The ball comes loose after the whistle. And while Steve Flacco did a lot of running on the play, he will still come up a good 4 or 5 yards short of the first down. As he came across the 45-yard line, and actually from the point at which he caught the ball, ran for about 8 or 9 yards, but from scrimmage, it was only about 4 yards. So Penn is in a fourth down and five, and Dave Bottomore comes in the game to punt. He gets it off. The ball is kicked end over end, bouncing across the 15, rolling at the 10, at the 9, and it is down by Penn at the 9. There is also a penalty flag thrown at the 49-yard line, and we will wait to see what is called right there. It could be a legal procedure against the Quakers. Offsides against Harvard. It is offsides against Harvard. It should be enough for a first down for Penn. We'll see where they mark the football. It was on a fourth down and five, and it should be enough for a first down for Penn. It will be a first down for Penn. First and 10 for Penn at the Harvard 44. Buro gives off to Flacco, who spins across the 45 and is tripped up at the 44 or 43. Actually lost a couple of yards initially and then kept spinning his way till he crossed the 44 or 45, and all he did was get back to the original line of scrimmage before Pat Fleming made the stop. Coming in motion is Jeff Schulte, the tight end. Buro keeping himself on his feet as he stumbles across the 44, but very, very little as Scott Muir, a very, very tough middle guard, makes the stop, and Gary Buro will not reach the 40-yard line. So it'll bring up a third down and seven. Third down and seven. The football on the Harvard 41. 5:18 remaining in the first quarter. The wide receivers are split. The backs in the eye. Gary Buro on play action has time. He's looking. He throws the ball complete inside the 25-yard line. He has Warren Buehler with a big first down. He puts it on the money to Warren Buehler on a deep slant on the money for 18 yards. First down, Penn.
Pennsylvania caught Harvard in a man-to-man defensive coverage that time. They sent a couple of linebackers, forcing the secondary defensive backs to play man, and a great throw and a great catch by Warren Buehler.
The give is to Flacco. Flacco getting very little as he bounces off people. Now comes to the near side, bangs his way across the 20, down to the 18, where Mike Dixon makes the stop. Mike Dixon carries Steve Flacco, but Steve Flacco showing his resilience as he bounces off of people almost pinball style. He hit a wall formed by Muir and Azelby and then just bounced back about a yard, stayed on his feet, came to the outside and picked up 5 yards. Receivers are split and Harvard will come offsides. The Crimson will come offsides as Gary Bura probably using a stutter count. So it will be second down and less than a yard for Penn. He goes for the sure yard and he gets it as Steve Flacco takes the pitch and carries people almost down to the 10-yard line. He'll be stacked up by Joe Azelby and Andy Nolan, but not before he picks up about 2.5 or 3 yards, and they will spot it at the 10.5-yard line, first and 10 for Penn. So Penn can pick up a first down without a touchdown if they get to the half-yard mark. O'Toole in the slot. First and 10 for the Quakers. The back start out on the eye. Bureau rolling. Pitches to Flacco on his feet at the 10, and he gets down to about the 9. Andy Nolan makes the stop, and this Harvard defense is playing the run very effectively. They don't give much.
That time, of course, they tried the option to the wide side of the field, and Gary Bureau made the pitch to Steve Flacco, who tried to come back against the grain. The fellas in the white shirts were waiting for them.
So for Penn, it is a second down and 8. Fulty comes in motion. Gary Bureau rolling to the near side. Still rolling. Still rolling. Hoops the ball for the end zone. Incomplete. Touched by Rich Sirik. He would have had a tough time bringing it down as he was falling. He was falling to his right. Had his back to the goalpost. He reached up. Jeff Schulte was behind him. They had two men basically in the same zone. And Rich Sirik reached up as he was falling. He touched it with his fingertips. Could not bring it down. So for Penn, it is a third down and 8. Bura in motion. He looks. Fires. Complete. Touchdown, Penn. John Vasturia alone in the end zone. Great faking by quarterback Gary Bura as he faked inside and then rolled to the far side. And John Vasturia was open in the corner of the end zone. And he took it for the touchdown. Penn leads 9-0.
Beautiful execution on the part of everybody in the blue jerseys for Pennsylvania.
Schulman for the extra point. The ball is spotted. The kick is up. The kick is good. There's a timeout on the field with the score. 10-10, Harvard nothing. It's 10-0 Penn with 2:24 remaining in the first quarter, and this Penn offense has been something.
Hi, this is Scott Boggio, defensive end of the 1982 championship team. Thank you for watching and for supporting Penn football.
Taking advantage of breaks, they took advantage of a Harvard fumble and went in for the field goal, the Schulman field goal on their first score. And there they took care of, took advantage of a Harvard offside that gave them new life after a punt. A very large crowd on hand here at Franklin Field. It appears larger than the Yale game when they had a crowd of over 30. This crowd must be somewhere around the 40 mark. Schulman tees it up. Here is his kickoff again. It is high, end over end. Taken by McNally at the 6. Up across the 10. On his feet at the 15. Comes to the 20. And is he ever belted and dropped at the 20-yard line? This Penn team is really fired up. And isn't it something to look across the way at the Penn side and it is packed. John Waterfield makes the stop. The Crimson of Harvard break from the huddle. 10-0 Penn. First and 10 for Harvard at their own 20. A double wing. Vacating the wing as Steve Ernst takes the handoff, goes to the 22, and that is it. Maybe the 22 and a half. Steve Ernst came off the wing, took the handoff, and Bill Lister was there. A minute and 55 seconds remaining to be played. The pitch goes to Granger, the fullback, and he gets to the 25, and he is stopped as Christiani makes the first hit. The Quakers scoring drive with 11 plays, 54 yards, 10 plays on their first drive, so ball control exhibited by the Quakers. The Harvard third down and 5, the ball on the 25. In motion comes Garvey, back the throw goes Donnie Allard, fires the ball to Ernst, complete at the 30, and he should have the first down. We'll see where they spot it. It will be very, very close. Jim Cook makes the stop for Penn, but the first down is attained by Harvard as they manage to move the football across the 30. First and 10 for Harvard, the football at the 30 and a half. A double wing slot, vacating the slot is Ernst. Ernst comes to the near side, comes across the 35 up to the 36. Tim Chambers makes the stop on Steve Ernst. A pickup of a couple of yards right there, making about 5 or 6 yards. Ernst has carried the football 3 times for 16 yards this afternoon. 11 seconds remaining as Donnie Allard lines up Harvard at a second down and four. The ball at the 36. Play action as Allard keeps. He runs across the 35, comes up to the 40, and is goaded right there by Scott Boggio and Mike Cristiani. And that will be the final play of the first quarter. There's the end of the first quarter. There's a timeout on the field with the score. 10-10, Harvard nothing.
Our beloved university is facing a landscape that we've never seen before. Empty classrooms, weight rooms, dormitories, dining halls, and arenas. From Shear Pool to the Palestra, Penn Athletics is in uncharted territory. Our coaches and student athletes are navigating these challenges, but they're looking to you and to me for our leadership, our community, and our support.
In the face of monumental adversity, our student athletes have responded with resilience, positivity, and strength. The world needs courageous leaders, teammates, and champions. Our student athletes are ready to take on this call. When we do return to play, we will be ready to win. It is our job to ensure our student athletes will be able to grow, compete, and win for years and years to come, be it with your volunteer leadership, as part of our mentoring and advisory network, or with your financial resources. You are needed now more than ever. The next era of Penn Athletics has arrived. With your help, we can set the future in motion.
By receiving an incredible academic and athletic experience at Penn,
I'm investing in myself and in my future.
Win the weight is about seeing adversity, not as an obstacle, but as an opportunity. I have been in awe of the support by our amazing alumni, parents, and friends during this time. In the face of our current adversity, we see an opportunity to come together as a team and a community. We will help one another maintain a clear focus on the ultimate goals and a clear purpose as we pursue excellence on and off the court. With your investment, we'll become even stronger in the future, and we'll hang even more banners in the Palestra. You can set the future in motion by supporting Penn Athletics today.
Penn invests in its student athletes, in our facilities, and our support systems so that we have the resources we need to succeed beyond athletics.
We aim big to provide our student athletes with the skills to excel far beyond athletics. New voices grow and emerge through the groundbreaking work of the Penn Athletics Wharton Leadership Academy. Our advancements in mental health and sports performance empowers our student athlete excellence through a diverse set of mental and wellness services. Our priorities around inclusion and opportunity aid our commitment to helping every student athlete reach their full potential. Your support demonstrates a commitment to helping us fuel the long game.
At the core of our efforts is preparation, determination, and focus. When the campus closed in mid-March, our student athletes were able to find unique ways to train and play the sports they love while acclimating and excelling in a new learning environment. Their perseverance helped them rise to the occasion. There are no shortcuts, no sidelines, no off-season. There will be a time when we can step back on the court, and when that time comes, we will be ready.
I am grateful for the life lessons that are inherent in sport. The 2021 season will be unlike any other, and every member of the Penn Athletics community is facing unprecedented circumstances. However, the resilience that sport has taught us will help carry us through moments like these. Every day, our student athletes, coaches, and administration put in the work so that when we return to campus, we will be ready.
Momentum is something we've worked hard to build and working even harder to sustain. We simply won't relinquish the ground we've gained against our peers.
Our world is facing one of the toughest challenges of our lifetimes, and like many institutions and organizations, Penn Athletics continues to be negatively impacted. Penn Athletics will come through this stronger than ever, but we need your support. We will win the weight by continuing to invest in our programs and our 1,000 student athletes, positioning them to compete for championships while preparing them to be leaders in their communities after graduation. help us set the future in motion by investing in Penn Athletics during these most difficult times.
Henschmiri back at Franklin Field getting set for action to begin here in the second quarter. It is 10-0 Penn. Harvard has the football just inside their own 40-yard line, so it will be third down and less than a yard for the Crimson. Johnny Allard lines them up and again sets the same formation, the double wing. In motion to the near side comes Steve Ernst. It's Allard himself carrying for the first down. He is thrown back. The crowd gets very enthusiastic as Bill Lista and Kevin Bradley knock him back. So first and 10 for Harvard as Donnie Allard's keeper worked right there. First and 10. Opening seconds of action here in the second quarter, 10-0 the Quakers. A double wing again. Ranger the lone setback. In motion comes Ernst. The handoff goes to the fullback. Big running room for Granger as he comes spinning across the 45, spinning across midfield, and in the Penn territory for the first time today at the 48-yard line where Tim Chambers makes the stop. But a big opener and 12 yards, a gain by Mike Granger on the play for Harvard. Again, the double wing. This time, the handoff to Granger, who breaks a tackle or two and comes across the 45 and deeper into Penn territory at the 43, where David Smith makes the stop. Penn is up 10-0, but this is a very, very big Harvard team, a very physical offensive line, which has been their key all along. This time, it's a double wing slot, the second down and 5. The handoff goes to the wing. Steve Ernst, who comes across the 40 and plows close to the 36-yard line, where he will have enough for another first down. Matt Finn makes the stop for Penn.
An important series for the Penn defense here. They had a critical play on third down at the end of the quarter where if they had stopped Harvard and forced them to punt into the wind, it would have been an advantage for Penn. They didn't get it.
It's first and 10 for Harvard on the Penn 36. Again, a single setback. The pitch goes off to Garvey, the wingback, who comes inside and crosses the 35 and comes down to about the 32. Scott Boggio made the stop. Garvey on his second carry today, and then of 8 yards. So they are using their wings as running back. They do that very often. Second down and 7. In motion goes Garvey off the wing to the far side of the field. The pass intercepted by Penn. Bradley picks it off, and the Quakers have the ball back. Donnie Allard wanted a quick looking pass as he faked it inside, gunned it over the middle to Steve Ernst, but Kevin Bradley was right there. He reached up, brought it down, flung it to his chest, and took it across the 35-yard line. There is another turnover. Let's see if Penn can take advantage. First and 10 on their own 37. First and 10 for Penn. Steve Rubin back in motion to the near side comes the tight end. Gary Bura on a keeper across the 40, across the 45. Up the midfield comes Gary Bura for the Penn first down. Joe Margolis makes the stop, but Gary Bura with 14 yards on the option. He was running and looking towards a man to pitch to, and I think the Harvard defense committed themselves, and Gary Bura galloped for 14 yards, has the ball just on the Penn side of the field at the 49.5. A slot formation to the far side. First and 10 for the Quakers. The backs are in the eye. Long count. This time it is a pitch to the tailback. Coming across midfield is Steve Rubin, and he will come into Harvard territory at the 47-yard line where Stan Martin makes the stop along with Louis Bersamis.
It seems almost as if Penn's offense has decided that this is going to be their day. The defense has gotten so much credit in their prior wins that they've established themselves very effectively here in the early going.
Second down and 7 for the Penn offense. They have the football at the Harvard 47-yard line. The backs are in the eye. Gary Bura keeping again. Pitches out to Rubin across the 45 and down to the 41. He will be close to a first down as Gary Bura pitched the ball wide to Steve Rubin. Joe Margolis made the stop for the Crimson, but he will come up about a yard and a half shy of the first down. So it is third and about 1.5. They spot the football at the Harvard 42. They will line up in a full house tee. He fakes. He gives off inside to Chuck Nolan, and we will see where they mark his forward progress. He will be close to a first down, but there are a pile of people on Chuck Nolan. They spot it at the 40, and they point forward. First down, Penn. First and 10 for the Quakers, and this time they set up on a slot formation to the near side. The backs are in the eye. Penn up 10-0. Second quarter action. Gary Bura on play. play action, rolling to the far side, still rolling, fires the pass out of bounds, and that time he was just trying to get rid of it. He was also hit pretty hard and is a bit slow getting up, but he's all right. But Gary Vura that time had a lot of pressure and did a good job of just getting his balance back as he was rolling to the far side of the field and throwing it out of bounds. Joe Azzleby rushing the passer. Second down and 10 for Penn. The football spotted on the Harvard 40. Vura gives off underneath to Reuben, and Harvard read that one, and they dropped Steve for a loss of a yard.
It's a little wingback trap play that they've used several times in the course of the year with much success earlier in the season. They shift Reuben up into the slot on the left side, and he comes back in motion, takes an inside handoff. That time, Harvard had either watched the films or had guessed right in the defense, but Reuben got stuck there right at the line of scrimmage.
A slot to the near side of the field. The football at the 41-yard line as Gary Vura comes back. He is rolling. He stops, fires across the middle, completes the pass at the 25-yard line. And making the catch is Nick Sirik. Rick Sirik leaping into the air. He really withstood a hit. I mean, Rick Sirik went up, and he was absolutely pulverized by Mike Dixon. But the 5'9", 175-pounder from Malvern managed to hold on. A 17-yard gain for the Quakers. First and 10 of the Harvard 24. Gary Vura floated the ball a bit, and Rick Sirik was belted. First and 10 for the Quakers. In motion to the far side goes Reuben. Lines up as a wing. Single setback. Wide receiver split. Vura straight back. He's looking. Floats the pass. Complete to Jim O'Brien. Complete to Jim O'Toole. O'Toole with the reception inside the 15. Down at the 14-yard line. Jim O'Toole. Another first down for Penn as Gary Vura is right on the money. Gary Vura is 6 for 10, 71 yards. Penn up 10 to nothing. They're driving again at the Harvard 14. Asturia comes back in. He is set to the near side of the field. In motion comes Reuben. He is set now as a wing to the near side of the field. The give inside to Chuck Nolan, who spins his way close to the 10-yard line. Chuck Nolan on the carry picks up about 4 right there. Bruno Perdoni makes the tackle for Harvard. Nolan's third carry of the day for 11 yards. Azzleby also in on the stop. So for Penn, a second down and 6. 8.5 minutes remaining in the first half. It's Penn up 10 to nothing, and the Quakers want more. Vura to the far side. Reuben sets up as a wing to the far side. Nolan the lone setback. Vura drops. Vura fires. Vura completes it to Reuben at the 5, on his feet at the 4. They say he stepped out of bounds at the 5, however, where he will be about a yard shy of a first down. Steve Reuben that time a receiver coming off the wing, and Gary Vura on target again. Joe Margolis, the man who knocked him out of bounds. So a third down and a yard. 8 minutes and 2 seconds remaining in the first half. Penn leading, and they want to increase the margin. One wide receiver to the far side of the field. O'Toole in motion to the near side. The back's in the eye. The handoff to Reuben, who shoves Tapen out of the way and has the first down. Steve Reuben across the 5 and down to the 3. Against Princeton, Steve Reuben was hit 3 times between the 5-yard line and the end zone. That time he was hit about 3 times on that short trip of 2 yards, but he gets the football down to the 3 with the Quakers in a first and goal at the 3. 7:49 remaining in the first half. Long count by Vura. Pitches to his tailback. Coming to the near side and leading forward is Steve Reuben. He will get nothing. He will be fortunate just to get back to the line of scrimmage. Louis Versamis, who plays what Harvard calls an adjacent, but is really a rover back in effect, is the man who makes the stop right there. And it'll be second down and goal from the Quakers at the 3-yard line. Our statistician, Bob Cherry, reminds me that Gary Vura has completed his last 4 passes into the wind. Now Amos goes in motion. Vura has the ball off inside, and it is Nolan getting down to about the 1. Nolan gets back to and down to about the 1-yard line where Pat Fleming makes the stop. 6.5 minutes remaining to be played in the first half. 10-10, Harvard nothing. Merrill Reese and Hench Mary here at Franklin Field, hoping you're enjoying the game. Saying hello to Penn alumni everywhere. Third down and goal. The ball at the 1. A full house tee. Everybody in tight. Vura gives it off to Nolan, who spins to the goal line. He will not get in. Joe Margolis makes the stop. And now head coach Jerry Burke is faced with a decision. It is fourth down and goal, and Penn will call a timeout. The football is at the, well, it is at a
about the yard line. Let's see where they spot it. Not the one. It's not at the half-yard line. It is a full yard away. 10 is up 10 to nothing. Do you bring in the field goal kicker at this point and try to go up 13 to nothing? They set up in the full house tee. They give Harvard the running look again. Let's see if it's a quarterback keep or what they do. Vura calls for the football. He gives off. They won't get it. As diving into the air is Chuck Nolan, and he cannot get in. And the Harvard defense comes off the field with their arms raised. Chuck Nolan on successive downs gained about a half yard, and that is it. As Chuck Nolan thought he could go over the Harvard defense, and he could not.
We felt good offensively. The defense put us in great spots, and you know, why not? And I think it was the right thing to go for it. The fact that we came up short and it wasn't 17-0 at halftime, I remember feeling disappointed. I mean, we're up 10-0. Intuitively, that's good. But, you know, Harvard probably went in the locker room at halftime thinking they had a win.
Andy Nolan and Joe Aslebby made the stop. But give the Harvard defense credit, because they tightened right there and they stopped Penn at the half-yard line. 5:57 remaining in the first half. It is 10-0 Penn. Quakers drove as far as the half-yard mark and could not get in. Harvard lines up with the backs in their own end zone. The handoff goes to Granger, who goes as far as the one, and that is it for him. A pickup of about the yard, a half yard, a yard by Mike Granger. Doesn't even get a yard, make it about a quarter of a yard. Granger remains the lone setback as Donnie Allard lines them up, and again goes to Granger, who flies across the five and is knocked off his feet at the six and lands at the seven. So Harvard in a third down and a long three, as they now have the football at about their own 7.5-yard line. The other wing is Garvey. The pitch goes to Ernst, and he has fumbled the football, then falls on it. Mike Ernst, the fullback, fumbled the football, then flopped down on it. Very, very wisely didn't attempt to scoop it up, and Harvard will have to punt, and Penn should have good enough field possession to try again. They should have some very good field position after this punt by Jim Villanueva. Here is the punt. John Waterfield on the near side. Looks up. Takes it at the 45. Fumbles. Picks it up. Returns it to midfield. And he is pushed back there. But he will go to the 49.5-yard line, just on the Harvard side of the field, where Mike Meade makes the stop for the Crimson. 4:08 remaining to be played in the first half. Penn leading Harvard 10-0. The Quakers got as far as the Harvard half-yard line on that last drive. Harvard held, but so did the Penn defense. And Penn's offense is back on the field. First and 10 at the Harvard 49.5. Rich Sirik split wide to the far side of the field. Warren Buehler to the near side. The backs in an open set. Amos and Flacco. Now Flacco lines up as a wing to the near side. Amos directly behind quarterback Gary Vura. First and 10 for the Quakers as the Harvard Crimson fake the blitz. Then Vura just hands off strictly inside. He goes to Rick Amos, who bangs into a few people and takes the football and carries it down to about the 46-yard line. A pickup of 3 yards on the play by Rick Amos. So a second down and 7 for Penn. 3:47 remaining in the first half. The near side, Buehler. One setback. That is Amos. Flacco is the wing back. The give is by Giro, who holds it himself, takes it inside, carries it down to the 40, and let's see where they spot it. He won't be far from a first down. Rasami's made the stop for Harvard, but Gary Vura picks up yardage on the play, 6 yards to be exact, and he has the ball within a yard of a first down. Jolte, the tight end, comes in motion to the near side of the field. Vura gives off to his fullback, and Rick Amos has the first down. Amos that time on just straight ahead running. Pat Fleming makes the stop. They've caused some confusion so far. Penn is 7-for-9 today on third down efficiency. First and 10 for the Quakers at the Harvard 39. Hero wants to throw. He loads up. He's going deep down the middle. The pass is banged around, and it is intercepted by Harvard. A tremendous interception in the end zone. Harvard comes up with it in the person of John Daly, who knocked it in the air. It was intended for Jim O'Toole, who was running a deep post pattern for Penn. And Gary Vura got the ball out there. It was a matter of receiver and defensive back running stride for stride. And Daly managed to get his hand in, tip the ball into the air, and then field it in the end zone. So Harvard has the ball back. First and 10 for Harvard. The ball at their own 20. They'll bring it out to the 20. O'Brien to the far side. The handy pitch goes to Gray danger of the tailback, who carries it all the way across the 30-yard line as he runs hard to the far side of the field. Comes up to the 31, where Ross Armstrong makes the stop in the Penn secondary. But a pickup on the play of about 11 or 12 yards. Now they say he went out of bounds closer to the 35-yard line. They will spot it at, let's see, precisely the 34. So a pickup of 14 yards, vacating the wing of Steve Ernst. The handoff goes to Jim Garvey, the other wing, and he comes across the 35 and comes up to the 37-yard line, maybe the 38. Scott Boggio made the stop for Penn.
Have to be very impressed with the coaching job that the Pennsylvania people have done with their young players out there. They're staying at home. They're reading their keys. They're not being fooled by a lot of the misdirection that Harvard's trying to throw at them.
He comes off the wing in motion to the near side. Aller, the quarterback, rolls on that side, waves people downfield, fires the football. Incomplete. Garvey drops it at the Penn 35.
Hi, this is Bill Lista, nose guard from the 1982 championship team. And thanks for watching tonight. And make sure to continue to support Penn football.
Garvey was open. Jim Garvey was open at the Penn 35-yard line. The ball was well thrown, but he had managed to get between Mike Okun and Ross Armstrong, but he could not bring it down. And Donnie Allard is only 1 for 4 for a total of 5 yards here in the first half. Third down and 6 for Harvard. The ball on their own 38. Back goes Allard again. He's looking. Fires to the far side. Has Garvey, and he drops it in the clear again. Garvey on successive plays has dropped balls right in his hands. That time he looked the ball into his numbers, and then it hit his numbers and bounced back. So Penn gets a break, as twice in a row, the Harvard receiver, the same man, Jim Garvey, just flat out drops the football, and Harvard will have to punt. A minute and 38 remaining in the first half. Penn up 10-0, and he gets away a beauty. It is spiraling at the 9. Tim Chambers takes it across the 10, across the 15, and grudgingly gets down to the 20-yard line as two or three men come over, led by Mark Neve, to make the tackle. So with 1:25 remaining in the first half, and Penn with the wind blowing in their faces, will line up first and 10 at their own 20-yard line. Things have gone very well for Penn. I think if you asked Coach Jerry Burke before the game, would you settle for a 10-0 halftime lead, he would have hugged you. He would have said absolutely. First and 10 for the Quakers. The backs are in the eye. Shorty, the tight end, comes off the wing to the far side and motion to the near side. Bura gives off to the tailback, but he won't go far. Flacco gets to the 21-yard line, and that is it. A gain of a yard. And hence, it would seem that Penn would be wise right here to run away those seconds on the clock and get out of this half with a 10-0 lead. Second down and 9 for Penn. 57 seconds remaining. The backs are in the eye as Bura takes his time, shows a great deal of poise as he looks over the defense. He pitches out to Flacco, who runs hard to the far side, fumbles the football out of bounds. Fumbled out of bounds, but it will stop the clock with 40 seconds remaining, which is not exactly what he wanted to do right there. Joe Margolis and Andy Nolan made the stop, and one of the ways to eat up those seconds is you run the football wide. But then when you fumble and out of bounds, you defeat your own purpose. Flacco sets up as a wing to the far side. Amos, the lone setback. And the handoff goes to Flacco underneath. Breaks a tackle across the 30, up to the 35. And Steve Flacco runs for the first down as Mike Dixon and Louis Versamis make the stop. And Penn should be able to erase those seconds right here. They move the chains, and the clock begins to tick. 30 seconds remaining here in the first half. Bura pitches to Flacco, who wants to throw, decides to run across the 40, across the 45, across midfield and into Harvard territory at the 48 with 9 seconds remaining, and Penn's calling a timeout. They aren't going to sit on any kind of lead. They're not going to sit on any kind of lead. And we have 9 seconds remaining to be played here in the first half. It is 10-0 Penn. Wide receivers are split. Flacco sets up as a wing to the far side. Amos, the lone setback, as Gary Bura wants to go to the air. He's rolling. He fires to Amos, who is tripped up at midfield, and that will do it. Pat Fleming makes the tackle, and that will do it for the half. There is the annual, very entertaining first half. That's the end of the half. The score, 10-10, Harvard.
Joining us tonight, some key figures from that game. Penn quarterback Gary Bura, defensive lineman Bill Lista, defensive lineman Scott Boggio, kicker Dave Shulman, and assistant coach John Lyons. Guys, thanks so much for joining us. The years leading up to this had been lean for Penn football. Did you guys feel like you were ready to make things different? What was the feel that you remember going into this season?
Going into training camp, I I think we were just sick and tired of losing, and it became a season of paybacks.
We had really good leadership in that group of kids. I just had a good feeling going into the season and throughout the years, we continued to have some success.
Scott, when was the moment for you during that season when you knew things were going to be different?
Well, I think the game against Dartmouth going up to New Hampshire and shutting them out the first game of the season served notice to the rest of the league that we were, you know, a team that to contend with.
Bill, what do you remember about the week leading up to Harvard as far as what you guys were preparing for, what you were expecting in this one?
Well, we knew that Harvard was, you know, that was always going to be a very difficult game. They come every year and, you know, we hadn't really measured up to them for a lot of years, but it was a really good week of practice and everybody was, you know, I think pretty confident going into that game.
Coach Lyons, give me what you remember of the scout of Harvard.
Like Billy said, I thought we had a really good week of practice. I think there was a lot of focus and concentration on what we were doing. I thought the guys really understood it. And I think they were just eager to go out there and play and go after those guys because they had handled us a year before.
It was definitely physical up front and physical for the first three quarters. But, you know, our strength training throughout in preseason and throughout the year enabled us to go up against offensive lines that were, you know, of that skill.
We weren't scared of them. It was our house. We had paybacks and there was a I think a united focus.
We knew that they had probably the best offensive line that we had faced all year, arguably. And, you know, we came out, we were pretty intense. Bill's intense, Mike Christiani, I mean, David Smith and Jim Miller and Jerry McFadden. I mean, we were holding our own. And I think I echo Bill in saying that, yeah, we felt like we were controlling the line of scrimmage.
What's it like on the sidelines just looking up and seeing that many people watching you play football? It had to be wild.
We were playing before a 35,000, you know, person crowd, which Franklin Field hadn't seen in years. So it was a euphoric feeling, I think, not just on the sidelines, but in the stands as we were, you know, progressing through the game.
You know, a lot of noise and certainly added to the excitement.
You're definitely pumped up and, you know, I don't think anybody was ready to let down. You just wanted to get back on the field.
Gary, it's 20-0. Do you remember what you're thinking there as you're walking off after that touchdown?
It felt good to be up 20-0 at that point. But again, you know, the defense was pitching a shutout and we should have been up more than 20-0. But yes, at that moment, 20-0 felt pretty good.
You know, it went from a feeling of, you know, kind of confidence and, you know, kind of continuing to press the issue to all of a sudden you're on a little bit of a slippery slope.
The offense had a flair for the dramatic to set up the, you know, the final drive and the kick.
We were three and out. There was a fumble, three and out, partially blocked kick. We're giving the defense short fields. All we needed was a first down and we couldn't do it.
You know, when the momentum moves that quickly in the fourth quarter, it's hard to come back from that.
What's that huddle on that first and 10 play?
I remember distinctly, nonchalantly saying, okay, guys, let's go down and get a field goal.
So 3 seconds, Dave, you're walking on the field. What are you thinking?
You know, what can I tell you? I mean, I tried to stay as calm as possible and try to make it as routine as I could.
And the realization that there's a flag on the play, is that a – like an emotional roller coaster, or is everything happening so fast it's kind of too hard to process?
Yeah, it was all happening really fast. It was hard to process. I just, in my own mind, I knew this just couldn't be the way this thing is going to end. I was lucky to get a mulligan on that, on the first one. And I thank God that we had that second opportunity.
And that game against Harvard was just unbelievable because they were a really good team. And to play as well as we did and have the lead, then to give it up, but then to be able to come back and win it with no time on it. It was just unbelievable.
What is it like after he hits the field goal? What do you remember from celebrating that victory?
You know, ensuing people coming in from the stands.
Just to see the students and everybody tearing down the goalpost and running around with them, it was wild.
It was pandemonium.
It just a total insanity. But you know, what a special ending to a miracle season, and for a group like this to come together and pull off a season like that. It was really very special.
Here is Showman's kickoff to begin the second half. It is end over end. It is deep in the end zone, and Mark Vignelli will not bring it out as he kneels 8 yards deep. They will march the ball up to the 20-yard line, and Donnie Aller, the Harvard quarterback, will bring his offense onto the field. So it'll be first and 10 for Harvard at their own 20-yard line. The wind, of course, is a big factor today, but first and 10 for Harvard at their own 20. The handoff goes inside to Scott McCabe, and he doesn't gain. In fact, he loses a yard.
The statistics that we've just been handed show time of possession, almost a complete reversal from what we're used to seeing with Pennsylvania. Penn controlled the ball for 19 minutes and 41 seconds. Harvard, 10 minutes and 19 seconds, almost a 2-to-1 ratio.
McCabe comes off his wing in motion to the far side. Allard running on the quarterback option, carries it across the 20, is tripped up at the 23, falls forward to the 25. Mike Christiani makes the tackle for Penn. So for Harvard, it's going to be third down at about 4.5. Third and about 4.5. Again, a double wing. The pitch goes to Granger, the tailback, who spins away from people, comes across the 30 and has a first down. Penn had him hemmed in. Penn had Mike Granger hemmed in at the line of scrimmage, and he just kept spinning away from people. The double wing with Mike Granger remaining in as the lone setback. The handoff goes to the wing, Scott McCabe, and he penetrates the Penn defense as far as the 33-yard line, where Mike Christiani makes the stop. We are in the opening minutes of play here in quarter number 3. It is Penn 10, Harvard nothing. A pickup of 3 yards by McCabe on that play, presenting Harvard with a second down and 7. The ball on their own 33. A Penn stands packed across the way. Granger in motion to the near side, and back goes Allard, but I believe it's going to be too much time for Harvard, as Harvard took a long time, and instead of a second down and 7, they will have a second down and 12.
That appears to be the call. They tried to run some motion after they had come up through the line of scrimmage.
Oh. Granger goes in motion to the far side. Aller floats it over the middle, completes the pass to Garvey across the 30, but he comes down close to the original line of scrimmage. Just a short gain as Jim Garvey is the receiver. Bill Lista makes the tackle for Penn, and Harvard will find itself in a third down and 9. Third down and 9 for the Crimson. Motion to the near side. Scott McCabe comes off the wing. Allard is rolling to the near side. Still rolling. Close the football downfield. Incomplete. Looking for McCabe at the Penn 45. Well covered by Mike Okun. Mike Okun with Scott McCabe, and Allard is now 2 for 7. Allard and Harvard not getting much out of the air game today. So Harvard has to punt at a 4th down and 8. The football on their own 32-yard line. Villanueva comes in the game, this time the punt with the wind against him. Deep for Penn. Tim Chambers to the near side. John Waterfield to the far side. Here is the punt by Villanueva. It is a high floater. Waterfield takes it at the 28. Gets away from the man at the 30, but is run out of bounds at the 33.5, and the Penn offense comes on the field. 11.5 minutes remaining in quarter number 3, and Penn is leading Harvard 10-0. So the Penn defense does the job once again.
Absolutely, and again, as you mentioned, that penalty, the delay of game, really hurt Harvard. They had a 2nd down and 6. The penalty put it back to 2nd and 11. They had a nice little completion of a play-action pass, but were unable to complete it on 3rd down. Forced the punt. Penn's got a chance to put some points on the board again.
The wide receivers are split on 1st down. It's Vera pitching the ball out to Flacco. Flacco runs it hard up to the 40-yard line, where he is banged out of bounds by Mike Dixon. Steve Flacco on the carry, picking up about 7 yards in the play. Make it 6, as they say that he stepped out of bounds at the 39-yard line. They say that he stepped out of bounds at the 39, so it is a 2nd down and 4 for Penn. Bura sets the offense. Bura gives off to Flacco, cuts to the outside, across the 40, on his feet at the 45, and Steve Flacco runs out of bounds at the 47-yard line. Some dipsy-doodling there by Steve Flacco, who was all hemmed in as he tried the inside route, then lowered the shoulder and maintained his balance, took it to the outside, came across the 45, went out at the 47. The backs in the eye, the wide receiver split. Gary Vera drops straight back. He fires into the middle. Completes the pass to Rich Zurich, who comes across the 30, and Zurich is tackled at the 26 by Brian Bergstrom. Rich Zurich with his second completion today. Rich Zurich with another reception. The first time he really paid a price as he withstood a bone-jarring belt, and he hung onto the football. That time it was a quick slant, and he came between the defenders, and he picked up 28 yards. Astoria comes in. Zurich goes out. First and 10 for Taylor. The ball at the Harvard 27-yard line. The handoff goes inside. It goes to Rick Amos, and he drags a few people down to the third 25-yard line, but not much more as Joe Azelby makes the stop for the Crimson. So Azelby makes the stop, a pickup of 2 yards on the play by Rick Amos. What a game so far for little Rich Zurich. Zurich has two receptions, but for a total of 43 yards. Flacco is set as a wing. The wide receivers are split. Bureau wants to throw. He loads up. He looks over the middle and completes it up the 20 to Jeff Schulte, his tight end. Jeff Schulte, the tight end this time. And he will be close to a first down. He will be shy of it as Louis Versammes makes the stop for Harvard. But he will be about 2 yards shy of a first down. Goes in motion to the far side, the backs in the eye. Bureau rolling, Bureau throwing, Bureau completing to O'Toole. Across the 15, out of bounds at the 13. But another first down as Brian Bergstrom bangs O'Toole out of bounds. But boy, was O'Toole open. I mean, there was the man within 5 yards of him as Gary Bureau picked inside and rolled to the far side and had Jim O'Toole wide, wide open.
If you're a Pennsylvania fan, it's certainly a pretty thing to watch.
Bureau gives the ball off inside. Amos across the 10. Amos across the 9. Amos tackled at the 8. Or maybe the 7 as Dixon makes the stop for Harvard. But Rick Amos on the carry that time. Andy Nolan also in on the tackle. So it is Rick Amos that time with a pickup of 4 yards in the play. 11 on the day for Amos, but 11 tough yards. A wing. Flacco the wing. Bureau wants to throw. He goes to the far side of the field. Incomplete. He looked for Rich Zurich in the far corner of the end zone, and Brian Bergstrom made a fine defensive play as he went into the air with Rich Zurich and got his hands in there, and Rich could not bring it down. So for Penn, a third down and 5 as Gary Vera just took a step back and looked into the end zone. Gary Vera just displaying so much poise. Third down and 5. And the wide receivers are split. Vera is back. Vera is looking. Fires incomplete. Is it intercepted? Harvard says it is. No, just incomplete. The intended receiver was Warren Buehler. The pass is incomplete as Andy Nolan stepped in front of him, but the Harvard people were yelling, the Harvard DBs were yelling, we had the ball cleanly, but the official said no, it touched the ground, and Penn on a fourth down and 5 will set up for a field goal. He gets it down, he kicks it, it's up, and it's good. Gary Gura had a tough time with the snap, and he finally got it down, and Dave Schulman converts on a second field goal of the day. There's a timeout on the field with the score, Pennsylvania 13, Harvard nothing.
This is Dave Schulman, place kicker on the 1982 championship team. Thanks for watching this historic game against Harvard, and appreciate all your support for Penn football and continue to support the program.
Penn coming ever so close to putting more touchdowns on the board, but they have only one of those and a pair of field goals. Here is Schulman's kickoff. It is high and end over end and taken by Vignoli at the goal line. Up across the 5, the 10, the 15. He is hit at the 18 and dragged down on a shoestring tackle by Tim Chambers. We pause 10 seconds for station identification.
This is Tom LeMay with the great songs of the 50s and 60s on the Memory Lane. Evenings from 8 to 11 on 610 WIP.
Spot the football at the 19-yard line for Harvard, first and 10. Head up 13 to nothing, 8:14 remaining here in the third quarter. Again, a double wing by Harvard, a single setback, and he gets the ball. Granger does as he comes across the 20, comes across the 25, and drags 10 people almost up to the 30-yard line where Matt Finn finally flattens him. But Granger running very, very hard for Harvard. He is their leading rusher. He entered this game with 294 yards. First and 10 for Harvard. The football on their own 29. The pitch again. The Granger starting to the outside. He won't get far. In fact, he gets little. Gets to the 30. Picks up a yard. That's it. Bill Lista says no more. Bill Lista stops him at the 30. So for Harvard, is second down and 9. Head up 13 to nothing in this game that
means at least a tie for the Ivy League title. Vacating the wing and getting the handoff is Scott McCabe. He is tripped up at the 30, comes across the 35, but there's going to be a penalty called, and it appears that it's holding against Harvard. It is.
And again, this penalty is going to create a difficult situation for Harvard. They've had a little momentum here. They had a great run by Granger on first down. Nice effort that time as the offensive back dove forward when he was hit at the line of scrimmage. Allard goes into a long count. Allard retreats. Allard fires over the middle to McCabe at the 20-yard line, bumps into his own man at the 25, and is put down right there. The football comes loose after the whistle. Jim Cook makes the stop, but that play was really botched up. When McCabe hit his own man, he appeared to collide with Jim Garvey at the 25-yard line, and that spoiled it for him. So he picked up 6 yards on the play. So for Harvard, it'll be a third down and 13, and again, a passing situation. Harvard not using the pass well at all today. In motion comes McCabe. Allard is rolling to the near side of the field. He's looking, pitches the football out to Granger across the 40. Granger at the 45 with a first down for Harvard. So it is Donnie Allard running the quarterback option and running it well. And at precisely the right second, pitching the ball to his trailing back, Mike Granger, who picked up yardage up to the 45-yard line. He needed 13 for a first down, and he had a sizable pickup right there as he picked up 15 yards for a first down. Needed 13, got two to spare. 5:47 remaining here in the third quarter. Again, the double wing. McCabe comes off the wing, and is he hit? Is he hit? He is hit by David Smith at the line of scrimmage, and does he feel that? David Smith was coming in as McCabe was hitting the line, and Smith just lowered his shoulder and flattened him. 5:20 remaining to be played in the third quarter. Granger the lone setback. Allard back. Allard looks the pitch, keeps it himself, and he is sliced off his feet across midfield in Penn territory at the 47 or 46. Puts tremendous pressure on Penn's defense. They're going to have to do something to compensate.
Third and one for Harvard. The football is fumbled. The football is fumbled, and Harvard has it. Harvard has it. It is recovered by Jim Garvey. It was fumbled as Allard tried to give it to Mike Granger, and the ball came loose, and it was an alert Jim Garvey diving on top of the football, not only recovering it, but giving Harvard a first down. First and 10 for the Crimson. 4:14 remaining. Allard running the option. Fires the football downfield. Incomplete. He was looking for Steve Ernst on the far side of the field, but even if Ernst had it, and even if he had caught it, which he didn't, he would have been out of bounds. So for Harvard, a second down and 10. The football remains at the Penn 39.5-yard line. 4 minutes and 3 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Harvard, back to throw goes Allard. Allard looking. He's going to run across the 40, and he is belted at the 38 by Kevin Bradley. Boy, does Bradley pop him. Boy, does Kevin Bradley pop Donnie Allard. He paid for that one, and all he picks up is about a yard. That is about it. Or 2 yards, maybe, as they spot the football now at the 37.5. Make it a third down at about 8 for Harvard. Third and about 8, but 3.5 minutes remaining in quarter number 3. Good. Allard is rolling. He pitches the ball over Granger's head. Granger goes back. Fumbles it again at midfield. A fight for the football. Penn's on it. Penn's on it at the 35-yard line. Recovered by Penn. A big, big play. The football was fumbled by Harvard. There's also a penalty flag down, but Mike Oakland is the man who came up with the football. Mike Christiani was chasing the football. He made a hit. The ball came off his hands, but it was fumbled by Granger, who went back after it, fumbled it again. You have all seen football follies on television, the thing where a pack of people chase the ball, and Harvard's being penalized for unnecessary roughness. The football is marched down to the 20-yard line. Flacco a wing to the far side. The handoff goes to the fullback. It goes to Chuck Nolan, who comes off right tackle, comes across the 20, comes down to about the 17. We are late in the third quarter. Penn is leading Harvard 13-0. And you get the feeling that 13-0 might not be enough against this Harvard team. You don't feel safe at 13-0. Second down at 8. Bura gives the ball off to Chuck Nolan again, who breaks the tackle at the 15 and comes hard down to the 13-yard line or 12-yard line. They spotted at the 12, and he will be about a yard shy of a first down. Pat Fleming makes the stop for Harvard. So
it is third down and about a yard and a half for Penn. The backs are in the eye. The wide receivers are split. Now the back shift out of the eye into a set left. In motion to the near side comes Rich Sirik. Jura is rolling to that side. He's going to run it across the 15, across the 10, across the 8, and down to the 5 goes Gary Jura with a first down. Louis Versano makes the stop for Harvard, but Gary Jura rolled to the near side, and you could sense that he was going to run because there was nobody in front of him. What thoughts he had of passing the football quickly disappeared as he carried for 8 yards on a first down and got a big block from Rich Sirik. Rich Sirik, the little wide receiver, leveled somebody out of the way. First and goal for the Quakers. They have the ball at the 5. O'Toole comes in motion to the far side. The backs are in the eye. The pitch goes to Flacco. Wedges his way across the 5, but only to the 4. Flacco gets only to the 4 that time as the Harvard defense tightens as it has so often when they are down deep. Warren Schlichting, the right tackle on Joe Azzleby, made the stop. They spot the football back at the 5, so maybe he didn't even get a yard. Second down and goal. The ball at the 5, and Penn goes with a full house tee. Full house tee. Jura on play action. Sets up. Close it for the end zone. Intercepted by Harvard. Intercepted by Joe Azzleby in the end zone as Gary Jura made a mistake as he looked into the end zone and floated the football. And if he could have brought it back, he would have. But no sooner did it come out of his hands than Joe Azzleby appeared at the goal line and picked it off for Harvard. And Harvard has the football back as Azzleby brought it all the way back to the 23-yard line, first or 27-yard line, first and 10 for Harvard.
We do a bootleg where all I got to do is fake play action and toss it over the head of a linebacker. And Bill, I've told you the story. Joe Azzleby was a linebacker. And all I had to do was get over his head, and Marty Dunleavy was there wide open. And I threw the ball, and subsequently we know Joe Azzleby, and I see him now socially, and I'll say, you know, Joe, I'll never forgive you for intercepting that pass in the end zone. And he subsequently ran it out to the 20-yard line. And I said, Joe, I'll never forgive you that. He goes, Gary, it was self-defense. This ball was coming at me. I had no choice but to catch it.
Mike Ernst comes in the game for Harvard. So Penn fails to capitalize on what should have been a big break. A double wing, first and 10 for Harvard. The handoff goes to McCabe, who is cartwheeled at the 30. The ball comes loose. Penn's on it. Jerry McFadden gets it back. The defense is doing it again, ladies and gentlemen. This defense is doing it for Penn here in the second half as they are repeatedly coming up with turnovers. Bill Lista applied the hit. McCabe fumbled the football. On it was Jerry McFadden, and the Penn offense comes back on the field.
There were so many guys flying to the football that two guys probably caused that fumble. We were in stride at that point.
So turnovers and the defense, you can't say enough about these guys.
It's going back and forth and back and forth. I don't think I've been as depressed all season as I was when Gary threw that last interception.
In motion to the far side goes Sirik. Jura is rolling to the far side, fires to the far side. Sirik catches it over his shoulder, and he's knocked out of bounds at the 22. Mike Dixon makes the stop. But isn't Rich Sirik having a ball game? Picks up only 6 yards on the fast and short out pattern. Just a simple short out to Rich Sirik, but he was running full speed and did a good job of turning and catching it over his right shoulder. He comes out. Bura spins. Gives to Nolan. Across the 20. Close to the 15. First down for Penn. 24 seconds remaining to be played here in the third quarter. If anything, at least the offense is chewing up the clock here in this quarter. And Harvard's offense has made some big mistakes. Slot to the near side. The handoff goes inside, and Nolan comes across the 15 down to the 13 on the final play of the third quarter. There it is, the end of the third quarter. One to go. There's a timeout on the field with the score. Pennsylvania 13, Harvard nothing. Back at Franklin Field, Merrill Reese along with Hench Murray. The Penn Quakers are one quarter away from at least a share of the Ivy League title. 15 football minutes away. They are up 13-0, so it is not sealed up. They have a second down and 8. They have the ball on the Harvard 14-yard line. Second and 8.
The backs of the eye. Shorty, the tight end, goes in motion to the far side. Play action as Bura turns, being chased, running, now firing the football, complete at the 5-yard line. 5-yard line, he finds his man, Chuck Nolan, and completes it inside the 5. So here we go into another first and goal situation. Penn has been in these situations 3 times today where Harvard has come up with big plays. But here it is, first and goal from the 3. 1 wide receiver. The backs are in the eye. The handoff to Flacco, who tries to barrel his way to the goal line. Gets to the 2, maybe the 1. We will wait for them to unpile and then spot the football for you. They say he reached. Well, let's see where they put it down. He reached the 1.5. So it is second down and 1.5 yards. Second down and goal from the 1.5. Slot to the near side. Sirik, the man in the slot. In motion comes Sirik. The handoff goes to Flacco, who drags people down to the 1, maybe. But Flacco collided with Gary Bura on that play. And it was very fortunate for Penn that the ball did not come loose.
There was obviously some problem on the handoff. There was a collision in the backfield. Great effort by Flacco to get back to the line of scrimmage. Penn's got to get in here.
It is third down at 1.5 yards. Bura on a long count. Pitches to Flacco. Off tackle. He's in. He's in. Steve Flacco. Touchdown, Penn. Steve Flacco for the touchdown. As Penn finally does it. They tried once, and they tried again, and they tried again, and finally Steve Flacco went in for the touchdown. It's 19-0, Penn, and here is Schulman for the extra point. To Mark Embro. What a block he threw, and give a lot of credit to Steve Flacco, who would not be stopped. Ball is spotted. The kick is up. It's good. There's a timeout on the field with the score. Pennsylvania 20, Harvard nothing. 13 minutes and 19 football seconds. Keeping Penn from the Ivy League title. They're up 20 to nothing. Here is the short kickoff by Schulman that bounces downfield and goes out of bounds at the 12. So now he will kick it off from the 35 with a penalty.
I'm sure lots of teams in history have been called the cardiac kids, but watching these fellas from Pennsylvania week after week get out front, get a lead. We were right in this exact same position last week against Colgate, where they were leading 20 to nothing with about 13 minutes left in the game. They proceeded to make the game exciting. I hope they choose to do differently today.
It's interesting that you say last year. Last year at this time, Penn was 1-7. 1-7. And regardless of what happens from here, Jerry Burt has to be one of the Eastern College Coaches of the Year. I mean, he just absolutely has to own one of those awards for his division. What a job he's done. Here is the kick. It's an onside kick, and it is picked up by Mike Ernst at the 35, and he takes it up to the 40. Mike Ernst, the short man for Harvard, picking the ball up and taking it up to the 40. So against the stiff wind, Harvard gets the advantage. Harvard has the wind at its backs.
I think it was intentional not to be an onside kick, but to try to keep it low against the wind, and it was not a very effective kick. Harvard's got good field position here.
First and 10 for the Crimson at their own 41. In motion comes Mike Ernst to the near side. Back to throw goes Allard. He's being trapped. He's being sacked. They got him across the 30, back at the 28. Jerry McFadden coming through the left tackle. He grabs Donnie Allard and spills him across the 30. He absolutely goes through Henry Cash. Jerry McFadden, 6'2", 220, just overpowers Henry Cash, who has him by about 12 pounds. Second down and 21 for the Crimson. Back goes Allard, looking for Mike Ernst. Close the pass, complete to Ernst across the 35, and he gets to about the 39-yard line, but not more. Gets close to the original line of scrimmage, where Mike Oaken makes the stop for Penn. That pass took a long time to get to the sideline. Very often when you measure a quarterback's arm, looking downfield and seeing whether or not he can throw the bomb isn't a really good test. But the measure of an arm is how fast can he throw, how much velocity can he get on that sideline pattern. Here he is on a third down at 11. Allard rolling to the near side. Floats it to the near side. Incomplete. Two men in the same zone colliding that time. Leaping for the football was Jim Garvey and also Granger. Incomplete. Oaken in there too. Mike Oaken for Penn, but they were
two members of the Harvard offense around that football at the same time. Fourth and 11, and Villanueva is in the punt. Waterfield back for Penn. Chambers to the near side. The punt is high, end over end. Chambers calls for a fair catch at the 18-yard line. 11:46 remaining in this football game. It is Penn 20, Harvard nothing. The Quakers break from the huddle. First and 10, the ball on their own 18-yard line. The wide receivers are split. The back shift out of an eye. Wing is Steve Rubin. The handoff to the fullback, Rick Amos, who breaks across the 20. Amos across the 25. Amos to the 27-yard line. Randy Scott makes the stop. Even those who felt that Penn had a shot in this game with Harvard thought that it would be a very, very tight game. They felt that if Penn was to beat the Crimson of Harvard, it would be by a couple of points. A second down and two after the gain of eight by Amos. The handoff this time goes to Rubin. Off left tackle, fumbles the football, Harvard's on it. Steve Rubin with his second fumble of the day, fumbles it at the 28-yard line, and Harvard's Bruno Perdoni comes off with the football. So Harvard has the football again. Steve Rubin had run for the first down, and the ball came loose, his second fumble. The first came on the opening carry of the day, and it comes again, and Harvard has the football, first and 10, the ball inside the Penn 30. 11:09 remaining in the fourth quarter. Still a lot of time. Steve Ernst comes in motion to the near side. Allard running with the football. Looks the pitch, fires the football. Controlled by Ernst inside the 25 to the 22. And let me tell you, Mike, Ernst juggled that football and it almost came loose. Ross Armstrong makes the tackle for Penn. The play nets 7 yards. But the Harvard pitch, the quarterback option as it is being run today, looks highly risky. Second down and three. In motion goes Garvey off the wing to the near side. Play action as Allard fires the football, completes on a quick slant to John O'Brien. Inside the 10-yard line, down at the 9.
Nice execution that time by Allard on a little play action, trap fake upside. He turned, really went around 360 degrees and hit his wide receiver slanting in. I think on the option play, I talked with Ed Zubrow and Wayne Donner, the defensive coaches, during the week, and apparently Allard has liked to run that himself, has not pitched very often.
The double wing, Garvey goes in motion, the handoff goes to Ernst. Mike Ernst, the fullback, carries it inside the 8, and he is stacked up by Dave Smith at about the 6-yard line. So it'll be second down and goal for Harvard, the ball on the 6. Second down and goal. The clock continues to tick. 9:45 remaining to be played in this football game. 10 up, 20 to nothing. Allard runs the option again, pitches the ball off, and he will not go. Ernst is stacked up at the 9. If anything, he will lose yardage as Kaden Nix and Mike Hogan make the stop. You talk about the job of the offense today and how well-drilled they have been, and we saw their execution at its peak, particularly in the first half. But this defense did its homework, too. I mean, they are ready for these plays, and they are stopping this option play that Allard likes to run and has run so effectively this season. Third down and goal. Puts Rutecki to the near side. Gives the ball off. No, he doesn't. Takes it back. Fires for the end zone. Touchdown. Peter Cordarrero, the tight end, was open on play action. A good job of faking by Donnie Allard as he put the ball in the belly of his fullback, Mike Ernst. Took it away. Took 2 steps back and found Cordarrero wide open 1 yard from the base of the end zone. So Harvard finally scores 20-6. Villanueva in to attempt the extra point. Here is the extra point, and Villanueva boots it cleanly through the uprights, and it is 20-7. There is a penalty flag down, but I believe it will be after the kick. It will be marked off on the ensuing kickoff. 8 minutes and 40 seconds remain here in the football game. It is Penn 20, Harvard 7, and Penn was penalized for roughing the kicker. But let's see if Harvard doesn't try something here. He tries the short kick. It is fielded cleanly by Penn, however, at the 25-yard line. One of the up men for Penn, simply Warren Buehler, just got under the football as Penn is wide to those things and will put receivers up in position to field that onside kick, and Warren Buehler fields it cleanly for Penn. Flacco is a wing to the far side. Rick Amos, the lone setback, the handoff to Amos, who comes across the 25, and as he ever hit hard right there. His Harvard defense wants to stop that Penn offense in 3 plays. They don't want any Quaker drives.
as Penn can just take the clock away from Harvard, who needs two touchdowns to take charge of this game. 8:14 remaining. Euro on play action, being chased, still being chased, rolling to the far side, keeping himself across the 25, across the 30, and out of bounds at the 31-yard line goes Gary Bura, as he had Joe Azelby almost within arm's distance as Azelby was bearing down from behind, chased him out of bounds, but Gary Bura picked up 6 or 7 yards. So for Penn, a third down and two. Bura on a quarterback keeper spins forward, leans forward, and backs forward, and I don't know if he made it. We'll see. Gary Bura seemed stopped initially, and then he twisted and turned and leaned forward with his back, and I don't know. I don't think he made it. He did not make it. He will come up a yard short, and Penn will have to punt. Dave Bonnemore in the punt. It is blocked by Harvard. It still bounces forward, and it is recovered by Harvard at the 43-yard line. Pat Fleming was the man who blocked that punt. It could have been disastrous, but he did not block it towards the goal. He more deflected it heavily. He deflected the ball, and it rolled forward across the 40-yard line, and it came to rest at the 46-yard line. First and 10 for Harvard at the Penn 43. Allard wants to throw. He fires incomplete. Allard was looking for John O'Brien at the Penn 30-yard line, and Mike Hoken filled the zone right there and banged it away. Second and 10 for the Crimson at the Penn 43. So it again is the defense with the pressure to weather. 7:20 remaining in this football game. Penn up 20-7. Now in motion comes Garvey. Back goes Allard. Has time. Fires. Completes the pass to Steve Ernst at the 35. Ernst at the 30. Ernst with a first down at the Penn 28 before Jim Cook makes the stop.
A lot of credit that time to the Harvard offensive line, giving Allard a lot of time to look at his receivers. They're sending five people down the field, and Penn's got to rely on that pass rush. We've been in this situation so many times this season. Somebody's got to make a big play and get the momentum back, and that's been typical of Penn's defense all year. Let's see if they can continue here.
We're inside the seven-minute mark. On motion goes Steve Ernst to the far side of the field. Granger is the setback as Allard spins, floats a pass, completes to John O'Brien at the 10. He's taken out of bounds at the 8. Tim Chambers bounces John O'Brien out of bounds, but Harvard has moved quickly, and they are inside the Penn 10-yard line with 6:41 remaining, and this drive has taken very little time. Penn is far from being out of the woods. First and goal for Harvard. Allard on first down gives the ball off to Mike Ernst, who carries inside the 5, down close to the 4. Ernst on the carry. David Smith makes the stop. We have 6.5 minutes remaining in this game. 6.5 minutes. O'Brien split out to the far side, a double wing. Allard is rolling. Allard has a man. Harvard has a touchdown. Steve Ernst, the receiver. Allard faked it inside, and Steve Ernst was wide open in the end zone. And things get more and more tense here at Franklin Field. Things get more and more tense as Harvard connects right there. And they are now within a touchdown. 20-13. Here is the extra point by Villanueva. It's good. It's good. And with 6 minutes remaining to be played, it is Penn 20 and Harvard 14. Well, Penn football has given everybody more than they can handle. What an afternoon. What a season it has been for Penn. But here they are trying to lock up an Ivy League title. Things look comfortable just a matter of minutes ago. Penn was up 20-0, and here we are with 6 minutes remaining in this football game.
I had seen this before from these guys, and they had the ability to score very quickly, and it just seemed that they got that break, and then they had all the momentum, and it was great up until that point, and then it was like, whoa, and then they started having some success and moving the ball and scoring some points on us. And then, like I said earlier, just the fact that we were able to come back and have the last drive the way we did to get that win was, it was a tremendous feeling.
And it's 20-14. Here is the kickoff by Villanueva. No onside kick this time as Glenn Shagney backs up and fields it 8 yards deep in the end zone, and he will not bring it out. They will march it out to the 20-yard line. So buckle up the seatbelts and get set for a very, very tense 6 minutes. First
first and 10 for the Quakers at the 20. Back shift out of the eye into a set left. Flacco in a tailback. Now Gary Drew floats the pass for Flacco, who comes across the 20 up to the 24. And that was dangerous right there, as they had shifted out of the eye and had Flacco set to the left, and Gary Bura fired the football high. Flacco reached up and brought it down with his fingertips, actually, and if that ball had come loose, it would have been easy picking for Harvard. Second down and 6 for the Quakers. Maxer in the eye. Bura on play action is rolling to the near side, looking, fires incomplete. What a Chuck Nolan, the fullback. Nolan could not hang on. Chuck Nolan, the intended receiver. Pat Fleming putting an awful lot of pressure on Gary Bura. And talk about pressure. The situation means pressure right here, because the Penn offense has to feel that they have to continue this drive. They have to move the football. There are 5 minutes and 17 seconds remaining in this game. And back goes Bura. Back goes Bura. He's looking. He fires. Incomplete and almost picked off. Almost picked off as Kevin Garvin, Harvard's Kevin Garvin, was over anxious as he raced for the football and was too animated as he tried to bring it in, because if he had just kept his poise, he could have fielded it, almost called for a fair catch, and run 25 yards for a touchdown. The Penn has to punt. Sam Coronati back to return as Bottomore does a decent job of getting it away, and Coronati calls for a fair catch at the Harvard 44-yard line. So against the wind, Bottomore does a pretty good job right there.
One of the difficult things with a pass-oriented offense is when you get down to the last few minutes of the game, you're trying to sustain the ball and get your committed to throwing it. When you throw the incompletions, you stop that clock. And Penn chewed up a little over a minute in that 4 snaps of the ball. Harvard's got plenty of time here to fool around with it.
The handoff goes inside and shoving and pushing people as Mike Ernst across the 45 up to the 49-yard line. David Smith makes the stop for Penn. Coronati, the Penn punter, doing a pretty decent job. That was his first punt. Bottomore was blocked the last time he did it. They brought in Coronati. Harvard second down and 5. Allard rolling. Allard fires a pass. Caught down the far side by John O'Brien. A one-handed catch inside the 30 at the 28. What a tremendous catch by John O'Brien, who leaped into the air, threw up a hand, and brought it in. It is inside the 30 at the Penn 26 and a half. 4:23 remaining. First and 10, Harvard. First and 10 on the Penn 27. O'Brien split to the near side. Allard fakes, gives off inside. Garvey, the wingback, takes it across the 25, and then most of the defense bangs him back at the 22. Jerry McFadden leaves that Penn defense, gang tackling that time. 4 minutes and 8 seconds, 4:07. But the Harvard offense has plenty of time. The Penn defense has to stop them. It'll be a second down and 5, and Mike Granger comes back in the game for Harvard. The lone setback, double wing. Motion is Ernst. Allard is rolling to the near side. Allard is being chased, gets away from the rush. He's looking, he fires, completes the pass to Cordarrero, and a penalty flag goes down. Cordarrero comes up with a catch at the 10-yard line, and there is a penalty flag down. Let's see who it's against. It is going to be against Harvard, an illegal receiver downfield. Allard, who was miserable in the first half, is now 10 for 17. He's back. He floats the pass. Has Granger open at the 20. Granger down to the 15. Granger down to the 15 on a third down and 10. They get Mike Granger out of the open, and he comes up with a first down. 3:13 remaining. 3:13, and Harvard in a first and 10. The ball on the 15. Now Granger comes back. He takes the handoff. Drags people across the 15. Down close to the 12. Mike Granger. Christiani makes the stop for Penn. Granger, 13 carries, 91 yards. Out of the game comes Granger. Back in replacing him is Mike Ernst. 2:42 remaining. Ernst, Allard runs the keeper across the 10, across the 8, across the 5, and he is knocked down. Let's see where they spotted it, about the 3-yard line. The clock will stop. The clock will stop as Donnie Allard, who has come into his own after a poor first half, has played a splendid second half, and Harvard has a first and goal at the 2. A first and goal at the 2. Now they start the clock. They had stopped it to move the yard markers. Apparently he did not make it out of bounds. We will tick down inside the two-minute mark. In motion to the far side goes Steve Ernst. Allard hands the ball off to Granger, who is thrown back at the five. Granger stopped at the five as the Penn defense was ready. Kevin Bradley and Joe Lorenz made the stop. 1:42. Harvard will call for a timeout. Wow. What a game. 1:42 remaining. Penn up 20-14. And it all boils down to the defense. Allard lines them up. In motion comes Garvey. Allard rolling to the far side. Still rolling. Carrying the football. Knocked out of bounds at the three by Joe Lorenz. So it'll be a third down and five, or third down and goal for Harvard at the three. Third down and goal for Harvard at the three. 1:37 remaining in this football game. 1:37. A third down and goal for Harvard. Again, a double wing. Allard backs up. He looks. He fires. The ball is dropped in the end zone. Incomplete. Intended for John O'Brien, who could not hold on to the base of the end zone. And Harvard has a fourth down and goal at the three. 1:32 remaining. Allard had his man, but John O'Brien, who made an incredible catch on the far sideline, could not come up with that one. Fourth down. Goal to go for Harvard. Allard up and over. Allard running with the football. Catches the ball out to Granger, who runs in for the touchdown. Granger runs in for the touchdown, and Harvard takes the lead. Harvard takes the lead as Mike Granger booked the pitch from Donnie Allard and went outside and ran in for the touchdown. And Villanueva kicks the extra point, which is good. So Harvard leads 21-20, but there is still plenty of time. A minute and 28 seconds remaining. When I say plenty of time, of course, I am talking in terms of time needed for Penn to get close enough to have a shot at a field goal. This one is not over yet. Here is the kickoff. It is short. It bounces across the 5 and it, or 15 or across the 10 and then goes out of bounds. So that won't help Harvard as Villanueva will now kick off with a penalty.
That'll move him back 5 yards. And, of course, Villanueva is a straight-on kicker. And apparently that time he didn't hit the ball correctly. I don't think he was trying to slice it or trying to do anything fancy.
Here is Villanueva. It is high and end over end. Glenn Chagney takes it at the end zone. He brings it out across the 5, across the 10, 15, and he is tackled at the 20. So Glenn Chagney hesitated as he went 4 yards deep and then decided to bring it out. But it's about the same as it is at the 20-yard line or just inside. Craig Euchre makes the stop for Harvard. First and 10 for Penn, 1:24 remaining, the ball at the 20. Penn offense. The wind in their faces. Gary Vera lines them up. He splits his wide receivers. The backs are in the eye. In motion goes Jeff Schulte, the tight end to the far side. Vera goes back on play action. He's being chased. He rolls to the far side, still rolling. Carries the football. Is hit at the 22-yard line. Andy Nolan makes the stop. Gary Vera was nearly sacked that time. All he does is pick up a couple of yards, maybe a yard, and the clock continues to tick. 1:11 remaining. 1:10. Penn sets up without a huddle. Slot formation to the near side of the field. The backs are set in the eye. Gary Vera looks over the defense. In motion goes Flacco. Vera is rolling. Vera is being chased, and Vera is sacked this time at the 13-yard line. And the clock shows 52 seconds remaining, and the Penn offense will call for a timeout. Third and 15.
As the Penn offense huddles on the sideline with the offensive coaches trying to decide what they're going to do here on third down, I think we have to remember that Harvard has scored their 21 points here in the fourth quarter with the wind at their backs.
Here it is, third down and 15. The wide receivers are split. The backs are in the eye. Play action as Bureau retreats. Bureau's looking. He's being chased. Still looking. Fires. A diving reception made by Rich Sirik across the 30 with a first down at the 32. Rich Sirik out of no place. And shaken up on the play is Gary Vera. Vera was shaken up. He was hit hard as he released the football. Well, a pickup on the play of 18 yards and a first down as Rich Sirik comes up with a great catch. 34 seconds remaining. Let's see what Rafiti can do. Then Rafiti goes back, fires to the sideline, incomplete out of bounds. Stops the clock with 24 seconds left. second down and 10. And back into the game comes now Gary Bura. Only the tight end is winged in motion. Now comes in motion to the near side as Bura retreats on play action. Floats it over the middle. Incomplete. And now it is complete. It's the second man catches the ball. Warren Bura was hit. The ball came out of his hands and Rich Searick caught it. 17 seconds left. As Rich Searick comes up with his fifth reception, give an assist to Warren Bura, the intended receiver. And Penn will call a timeout with 17 seconds left and the ball on Harvard's 48.
I remember Warren's hands on the ball, and then there was a roar. So I didn't know. I just assumed he caught it. I didn't realize it was a bounce and a re-catch.
Penn is one long reception away for winding up for a field goal attempt. I don't believe this game. I don't believe the way this game is developing. The ball at the 48 of Harvard. In motion comes Flacco. Gary Bura is rolling to the far side. He's looking, rolling, fires the ball. Complete to Warren Bueller. Warren Bueller inside the 35 and kills the clock when he steps out of bounds at the 32. 10 seconds left. 10 seconds left. 32-yard line. If they were going in the other direction, I would give a field goal a chance. But they are going against a very stiff wind. And it is not realistic to believe that David Schulman would have a chance from here. 10 seconds left. Penn leads about 15 yards. Gary Bura rolling, being chased, fires the pass, completes the pass, and being taken down at the 20-yard line. 3 seconds left. Flacco at the 20. And the Quakers are not going to let this game go. David Schulman is going to come onto the field and try the biggest kick of his life. 3 seconds remaining. The ball will be spotted at the 28-yard line. It's spotted. The kick is away, and it is fading. It is fading. It is no good. But there is a penalty flying. We will wait.
So I was holding, and I knew right away that not only did he duck hook it, but it was definitely roughing.
I knew I had missed it, I was. But somehow after I got hit, I clearly did not think this game was going to be over. And to this day, my favorite color is yellow.
And a game cannot end on a penalty. The scoreboard shows 0-0. And Penn will call a timeout. I don't know how you can take a timeout when there isn't any time. And they spot the football now just outside the 10-yard line. It is a big penalty against Harvard. It is a big, big penalty against Harvard. Obviously a personal foul.
Absolutely unbelievable. No time left on the clock. Here comes the kicking team back onto the field. It's one shot for the championship.
I look at Gary. He looks at me and he says, just like practice, let's do it.
Here it is, ladies and gentlemen. Penn wins or loses it right here. Here it is. The ball is spotted. The kick is away. It's long enough. It's good. Penn wins. Penn wins. Penn wins the Ivy League title. Penn wins the Ivy League title. I don't believe it. Penn wins the Ivy League title. Do not believe this sequence of events. Absolutely incredible as David Schulman kicks a 27-yard field goal and Penn wins the Ivy League title. Wow. We will try to compose ourselves. I have a feeling we will not do that. We will be back at the wrap-up in just a moment.